Добрый вечер, дорогие друзья.
Good afternoon, dear friends. We are today in a very strange situation. In the lobbies, we already exchanged our opinions before this roundtable due to the breaking news of this day. Maybe our roundtable is not interesting to anyone after such breaking news. But judging by the audience in the room, the topic is quite pressing, isn't it? The topic still is important, since even at the background of such events, we have a full house here. Not because of the reasons I mentioned, but due to some circumstances, Mr. Kochukov most probably will not be able to attend our discussion today, although he still is the acting Minister of Science and Higher Education. But physically, since he was in the White House, still now he will not be able to join us, although, as he tells us, he will do his best. We have a good replacement instead of Alexander Sergeyev from the Russian Academy of Science. We have a replacement, a Vice President of the Russian Academy of Sciences. Let me pass over to our discussion. I'd like to introduce our distinguished participants in the order of their presence here in on the stage. First of all, Vadim Medvedev, Ministry of Higher Education and Science of Russian Federation, Anatoly Chubais, Chairman of the Executive Board of Rosnano Management Company, Оксана Тарасенко, Deputy Minister of Economic Development of the Russian Federation, Юрий Балега, Vice President of the Russian Academy of Science, Nenad Popovic, Minister of Innovation and Technological Development of the Republic of Serbia, and Sergei Polyakov, Director General of the Foundation for Assistance to Small Innovative Enterprises in Science. It's a long name of the position. Our topic today sounds innovations in Russia, planning for the future. And before we discuss future, although we have a good reason today, we are able to provide instructions to our future government, which will be announced in the nearest months until it's done here. Maybe in this room we have the members of the future government, and they will hear it. From the very beginning, I'd like to listen to the opinions of the distinguished members of the panel, their opinion on the current state of the innovative development in our country. We passed quite a long journey of creating the national innovative system, which was gradually born from the scientific policy by 2007. It was shaped, its innovative statues, the infrastructure came up, the new institutions came up. A few years ago, the strategy for innovative development was written, and it systemized somehow and streamlined the innovative development of the country. It was structured in a way that all components of the development should become innovative, innovative human development, business development, and others. Something was successful in terms of infrastructure and innovative institute, part of the ecosystem. We received venture investment, which didn't exist in Russia before. Now we have it, maybe not the full volumes, but at least all the institutions are there. At the same time, we have a feeling, both experts and in general, there is a feeling in the public, in the community, that the innovative development topic, compared to the mid-noughties when it was discussed very broadly, now it is going a little bit aside, and it's going to be replaced by other equally important stories. We now have the National Technological Initiative, which is a good story, but it is still focused on separate disruptive technologies and markets. Now a huge attention is paid to the development of the digital economy. There is a national project, national program on that. And these two areas, national TE and digital economy, they do not exhaust the whole innovative agenda of the country. And if we express the essence of the innovative policy and economy, which should be attached to this, is that the majority of enterprises, of businesses functioning in the country have to constantly work on the improvement and updating their technologies and products, and should bring something new to the market every year. Speaking briefly, this is the main essence, the main point of the economy. All the data, unfortunately, show in our case that we are far from being having it, less than 20% of enterprises which could be considered as innovative. For developed countries, 40, 50, and 60% is a norm. This quantum leap should be made. Moreover, our president last time set the task to bring this figure up to 50%, and the innovative policy which has to be responsible for that. No, well, it's not present as an express policy, maybe. And right today, we'd like to discuss our achievements with all the participants. We'd like to see the evaluation of the current situation and maybe give some advice and recommendation to the new government. What shall we do about the situation, how to streamline the innovative policy and how to develop it. Since we don't have first two speakers, I'd like to ask Mr. Чубайс to start. We will come a little bit later to the Academy of Science. Mr. Чубайс, given the fact that you are one of the ancient, if you may use this word, the development institutes of the first wave, and moreover, when Роснано was created in a different logic, not in INТИ and digital economy, and it doesn't fit neither in either of areas, how do you see the achievements and the successes of the current situation, and where shall we move with our innovative policy now, on your opinion, in order to cover and to provide necessary development of innovative agenda? Thank you very much. I received the floor now as the representative of the most ancient institute, Роснано. We were basically one of the first, one of the pioneers, and a good chance to take a look at the long-term dynamics. And Mr. Фомичев proposed to take a horizon of 10-15 years. I think it's correct, and I would like to mention 2-3 main successes and 2-3 main failures. Let's start with failures, because it's a good time. We can quickly criticize our government, and we will use this chance. We don't have the old one, but don't still have the new one. Let's start with the failures. Mr. Фомичев mentioned the strategy for the innovative development of Russia, 2010-2020. It's not by chance, because he is the deputy minister, was involved in creating it. It was a serious document, in my opinion. The Ministry of Economic Development provides official data on its fulfillment. Since the document is very good, there is a very strict digital parameters by years, starting from 2010 to 2020. If you are interested, you can take a look at statistics. And if we do not go away to diplomacy, everything was failed. Well, everything was messed up in this. And if we go over to diplomacy, we should say that, unfortunately, all tasks were not fulfilled to the end, if we put it like this. My first phrase, please cut off. It's not for the records, and let's leave for the record my second one. And well, if we do not speak about the emotions, then none of the set indicators will not be fulfilled, and in some of the indicators, it's not a positive, but the negative trend, not to plus, but to the minus. And this, of course, is very sad story, by the way. That's first. Second, I believe that if we take the qualitative level and we try to evaluate the situation on qualitative level for these 10 years, none of the state-owned enterprises nor big private business, the innovations have become a priority. Well, if they didn't become a priority for the government, we see that the document is not fulfilled. It means that it was not a priority. So in this case, in our country, the ties between the business and the government is very strong. It has not become a successful thing. But if you take and a request for the official statistics, you will receive a lot of books and reports on the innovative policy. But then I do not agree. Unfortunately, it has not become our priority indeed. And the third very important thing is that still our innovative technology and innovative economy requires the comprehensive institutions. Some of them were created, I'll tell you about it, but the most important institutions, maybe the most important ones, turned out to be not there, not present. And every innovative process requires the funding system, and the funding system, innovative technology, works on the rules. It has three layers: startups, first level, then the second level is venture funds and private equity funds, and the third is the funding sources for private force. We do have startup, we have VCs, but no funding source. We have the pool, but no water in it. And this, in this pool, basically, we are all playing around. These are three main failures, which I have to mention. But at the same time, I believe we need also mention some successes. Let's start with the very simple one. Imi preliminary. Let's not forget that the task, which is called creation of the countrywide innovative economy, is a very large task, which is sorted out by the U.S., by Korea. On my opinion, was accomplished, and I agree with experts who say that it will need 15 to 20 years. We have only 10 to 12 years still. So from this position, we should take it into account. What about the successes? The first and foremost success, the simplest one, the basic terms, is the language in this area: startups, innovations, venture funds, private equity funds, and a lot of other measures. They didn't exist 10 years ago. At our GAIDAR forum, we did not put these questions. We didn't have these problems, these terms in the government. They just were born just recently. We can, argue that we don't have a comprehensive system, but still we should take into account that this terminology still exists. There is a whole community of people who include dozens of thousands who really are involved in it, and this is already a movement forward. And we know that the inertia of stillstand is bigger than the inertia of movement. It's very easier to move from what we have to what is better. And it was mentioned that many elements of the structure and situational structure were built, for example, in the legislation. We also understand very well that the innovation economy as is require legislative forms of business which do not exist without this economy. In particular, venture funds or a private equity fund. It's not mutual funds, not LLCs. It's just a separate form which requires legislative formulation. It is created. This law was created very hard, with and the second edition, second release was adopted. This law is embedded in all the whole system of intercompany relations. The tax code takes it into account for investment communities. This is a very important part of structure. As an example, these institutions were built in the country, and this is very important. Third thing, I believe that creation and functioning of state development institutions is a very important positive result, not because I represent one of these development institutions. I'm not talking about myself. For example, let's take Skolkovo. I believe that Skolkovo is a real breakthrough. It's a real breakthrough to the future. We will see it as an active result, as a real result, after 5, 7, 10 years, not earlier. Starting from Skoltek University and up to everything which is there. But this is a real breakthrough, which after the serious attack, serious fights, and well, overcoming all this problem is still there. It is developing. In the same way of Sergei Gennadievich Bortnik with this wonderful foundation, of not 10, but 25, 26 years.
It's hard to imagine.
If you are ancient, he is the pre-ancient, prehistory, because they were created before the innovative policy creation. This is the institution, which is the ancient institution at Rosnava. I believe that all these institutions are created and they are very positive. So in my understanding, we have obvious failures and we should not conceal them, and there are obvious successes. If we sum it all up, I would say that some half of it is done. The half of the journey is done. And it's a recent result. Once there is a very good work with the analysis of share of executed commitments. Mr. Dmitriev did it. And our indicator is 50%. It's a good indicator of our initiative for this big state machine. The locomotive, the steam local had 7%, and we have 50. It's a good sign. So qualitative the situation is better as it was 10 years ago. But I see big gaps, big missed parts of this job. In this building, we see some beams not covered and holes in the walls, but we need significantly change the situation, at least within the next 4 to 5 years. And how? The question is how? Well, our session is planning for the future. I've become a solo player here. Well, just... It's be careful with this. You asked me how. Okay, let me. We didn't. We didn't agree on these hard questions. It's the initiative of Mr. Fomichev. Okay, my position on that. If we take a very sober look, we understand very well that the innovative sphere, as already mentioned, was not in the list of priorities of the government and will not become the priority of the government in the next 5 years. Shall I prove it or not? No, I won't. Okay. So let's proceed from this fact. It would mean that we should not expect a global breakthrough here. Nevertheless, what is realistic? What could be achieved? Are there any things which could be achieved with not very big costs, but which could significantly change the situation? Two examples. First, without any considerations or recommendations from my side, we do know that we have priority projects, national projects, and we have the digital economy project among them. We are deeply involved in it. I believe that this is a large-scale story which will strongly impact the whole investment climate in the country. As we mentioned, Oleg mentioned the strategy. It used to be good, but it lacked resources. There was a comprehensive document without resources. What does it mean, the national economy project? This is a project with huge resources, 1.3 trillion budget resources and 400 billion leveraged resources, 1.5 trillion. It's a very adult story, if you may. Yes, we have 156 problems. Yes, I admit that they don't provide proper realization, proper pace of implementation, only 70%. Okay, but I will try to have a larger, enlarged look. I really believe that given these resources, this project will sustainably change the landscape of the Russian economy after 4 to 5 years. What is the drawback? The drawback is that the the products here. We do have products. They are embedded, included with the whole list, which is called quantum computers, quantum communication, 5G. I'm not going to go deeply in the technology. There's a list of projects which the government works on. Sometimes it would be a mistake, but nevertheless, the whole list of the project is adequate and the resources are proper. What is lacking? Products are okay, but institutes are not okay. This project is not about institutes, but about products. And here, in my understanding, we can achieve more if we would be focused on building the innovative institutions which we lack. Those gaps in the walls, these pools without water, that's what we should focus on. A very simple and obvious example. We're not the first in the globe who are building the innovative technology. Venture funds cannot live without funding sources and for VCs. VCs which live with only what they earn, it's just a small peanuts. It's a poultry that we have. If we do not create the third level of architectural financing, we will have these smaller things only. What does it mean, third level of architecture in the innovative economy? Maybe I repeat, sorry for that, I will finish soon. But you are to blame, you all ask this question. It's very good to know that the Fund of Churches are four classic institutions, funds, endowments, former offices, and state pension funds. Take a look at the dynamics of the private equity dynamics in the States. You will see a very interesting story. 1970s, 60s, 1975.
So, if you can understand me, what happened in 1965, it actually enables to invest part of its activity assets into the private equity business. The source, due to a number of historical reasons, we will not have the sufficient amount of information, we won't have any familiar anything like this, we have the spectacular resource. NPM. Yes, of course, I do understand that the social risks are there. Yeah, we do understand that you cannot risk with the retired people. But still, I believe that it's not like, you know, the state approach, but we cannot look at this as a problem. This is the severe state mistake. You shall not try to resolve it by wiping everything now, but you need to take very accurate and careful action. 5% of assets, 3%, 1% of assets, risk-oriented approach, etc. and so on. It is absolutely clear what way you can actually do this. And if you do not open up this faucet, you're going to get the pipette-like or drop-light venture business that shrinked last year by 20-30%. That is what we have. This is my proposal what to do. Thank you.
Кроме тех вопросов, которые вы вначале задали, еще и выступление Анатолия Борисовича станет поводом для обсуждения с остальными участниками. Я надеюсь, у меня вопрос как Саня Тарасенко. Министерство экономического развития, теперь уже, я бы сказал, исторически с 2007 года, отвечало за выработку и реализацию инновационной политики. Как раз вот если мы там ее дифференцируем от научно-технической, научно-технологической, к которой мы чуть позже перейдем, к Миннауке экрана. Именно инновационные – это стимулирование бизнеса, если его широко понимать, в том числе через выстраивание инфраструктуры, создание разных правовых режимов территориальных и так далее, через создание новых инструментов, стимулирование бизнеса быть более инновационно активным. Вот как Минэкономразвитие, вот уже в новой ипостаси, я бы так сказал, потому что... Нет, ну, в новой и старой я имею в виду, потому что все-таки команда сменилась в министерстве, отвечавшей за инновационную политику. И, наверное, вместе со сменой команды, это логично, должны как-то трансформироваться взгляды, появиться какое-то новое видение на то, что дальше делать. Как министерство расценивает текущую ситуацию, то, что сделано, и как министерство считает, что нужно двигаться дальше.
Thank you very much for your question. First of all,
I would like to say that, of course, the strategy of innovative development is
не закончилась, да, она в течение этого года будет действовать.
Still ongoing.
Это замечательная стратегия, которая охватывала вообще все возможные, аспекты инновационной деятельности,
то есть то, что,
к сожалению, вот я сейчас зачитаю на статистику
им
достигнутых показателей, у нас только 3, доля молодых ученых, количество пользователей центров коллективного доступа, а также доля расходов на образование. Но при этом, все равно, скажем так, на стратегию, скажем так, обращали большое внимание, и те же самые дорожные карты, что цифровизация и соглашение, и создание инновационных кластеров, и поддержка высоких технологичных экспертов, это все из-за стратегии. То есть эта стратегия нельзя сказать, что она полностью не реализована. Все равно,
that it is not fully implemented.
Все ФАИВы, они действовали в своих, скажем так, программах, исходя из этой стратегии. Поэтому в любом случае новый документ, он будет крайне необходим. Как он будет называться в составе нового правительства, это уже другой вопрос. Концепция, стратегия, там была попытка сделать федеральный проект, но, соответственно, эта история не состоялась. Но я что хочу сказать? Я хочу сказать, что у нас в законодательстве даже нет такого понятия, как инновация. То есть вот мы innovation. Все должны понимать, что те статистические данные, которые мы собираем,
collect,
они не основываются на четком понимании, что такое инновационная компания. И в стратегии до 2020 года, там, в 2020 году, я вычитала инновационных компаний в промышленном правом секторе, должно было быть 40%. Соответственно, 204-й указ, он там повторил, но по-другому, там звонит технологические инновационные компании, и там до 2024 года должно стать 50%. По результатам прошлого года у нас 19 and 8.
So we still have
things to do. And I agree with Anatoly that
we've issued a great number
of important approvals where
we have the opportunity
to grow and develop. And of course, we have a lot of barriers.
We just work with the owner of the president related to the decrease of risk into the investment of the valley of death so that we have the right for a mistake.
Но, тем не менее, мы должны, как министерство, в будущем, видимо, обеспечить дешевое, скажем так, сопровождением этой инновационной компании от зарождения до выхода на экспорт. Для этого, скорее всего, мы должны как-то скоординировать все институты развития. И у нас даже есть соответствующее поручение в части необходимости, скажем так, чтобы компания, чтобы стартап не мучился с постоянным сбором дополнительных документов, подачи
документов,
технического развития занимается там квантовыми компьютерами. По сути, появился рынок.
In reality, we have
и, конечно же, сейчас компаниям необходимо искать
свое место в тех национальных проектах,
we should look for its place as a national project that already exists.
What they're going to have the new strategy to 2030. Но то, что явно должна быть концепция,
but it shall be the concept. This is 100% guaranteed, because this order and all the national projects,
they bear this innovative and technological essence. But nonetheless,
we have a specific information for the innovation, and it doesn't give any numbers or any indicators. We don't have any roadmaps or anything else. So,
мы как министерство видим вот такую ситуацию, Олег Владиславович.
Спасибо большое. Единственное, что все-таки вынуждены справедливости ради немножко тут поспорить в части определения инноваций. Я просто сам был представителем правительства по соответствующим поправкам закона науки, научно-технической политики и внесены соответствующие термины достаточно давно. Термин инновации, инновационный проект, инновационная инфраструктура, инновационная деятельность. То есть в этом смысле, конечно,
in this part, of course,
я здесь не противоречу в остальных частях выступления, просто скажу, что правовая основа, значительная часть инфраструктуры действительно создана. Здесь даже особо не к чему придраться, но определение есть, помогает это или нет. В свое время почему-то было понимание, что пока мы не внесем в закон понятие инновации, у нас в стране не будет инноваций. Внесли понятие инновации, мы будем...
Станислав,
готовы с вами спорить?
Maybe not right now, but later on. I'm talking about the collection. We all know that we have to follow the order 204 about technological and innovative. And Rostat collects the statistics. And we need to correct the understanding of innovations and everything. And therefore, we have implemented this new term.
Okay. К историческому институту развития вопрос. Сергей Геннадьевич, у нас, если по-крупному смотреть на российскую инновационную систему, две есть на уровне бизнеса неравные составляющие. Первое – это существующий бизнес. Крупный, средний, там, рожденный в 90-е или в советское время, по сути, там перешедшие в новые формы. И новый нарождающийся, малый и вырастающий его средний инновационный бизнес. Пока эти две категории сильно не равны. Первое, просто на порядке больше, и отдельная задача, как сделать так, чтобы и в этих предприятиях, которые были построены просто по другим принципам, чтобы они стали инновационно активными. Но вторая не менее важная задача – это сделать вот этот вот сектор,
it's quite important to do the sector of generating companies
or startups or spin-offs, small innovative things, that we created as many as possible, that we increased. Вот в целом в экономике все большую и большую долю, потому что у них уже, как говорится, в ДНК встроена история с постоянным технологическим развитием, с инновациями и с быстрым ростом. Вот вы институт развития, который, ну, по сути, у самых-самых корней этого процесса, вы поддерживаете даже еще не компании, а одна из программ, это поддержание будущих инноваторов, которые приходят к вам с идеей, вы помогаете им даже создавать компанию. Как вы видите, значит, текущую ситуацию и что сделать для того, чтобы это количество росло сильно большими темпами, чем оно росло в последние годы и в настоящее время?
Спасибо.
Thank you.
Во-первых, я все-таки хотел на основной вопрос ответить, в каком мы фазе находимся. Во-первых, я совершенно согласен с Анатолием Борисовичем. Мы где-то, наверное, половину пути прошли. Конечно, радоваться, но еще рано, что мы много чего сделали. Но из достижений я бы еще добавил, что за этот период времени, с того момента, когда вообще об инновациях никто не говорил, мы ведь, на самом деле, ни один институт развития не ликвидировался. Вот это тоже, я считаю, достижение. То есть они появлялись новые.
We see new institutes appearing, the previous one continue working, and we don't have any case when one of these institutes decided to terminate its existence. And if we say that if we are halfway there, it's not that there is nothing wrong here, because Russian nation has one interesting property, so we start slow, but we go fast. Therefore, do all that we will speed up, and there is a hope that we are not yet going, but we are getting ready. Because in reality, all these elements of developed information innovation system is here. Venture business, the direct investment funds, startups, it's a different thing that virtually every single element is not that developed. And if you want to go to the developed system, you need to do a breakthrough attempt. If you say about the question, how we can make, if you want just, you know, to create the thing,
so how can we make
new companies to appear, grow, and develop? I agree for sure that there is no system to catching up the startups. The venture investment system is the institute that shall invest into startups and do it seriously. If we're talking about the support of startups from our fund, we see that initially we can do the startup, we can actually finance a bit in order for them to get some taste of the business. There are, of course, business angels, some state support, but when the company starts growing, we have a failure here. There is no institute that would catch these startups and actually take it to a serious level. We have yet another problem that relates to some other companies.
What we lack?
At the moment, we don't have enough cases of growing global leaders. We do a lot. And we have the national champion programs, ranking of technical success. We have a lot of attempts, but the real try, the real attempts is not there. The reason it helps is because we don't study the history of the success stories. We need actually to do the case studies. We take great foreign cases. It's like, you know, we take the leading companies, give them max support,
enough grow,
your own Googles and Nokias and so on. We're not there yet. We are not able to do it to the amount we need or want. But it's clear that we still have to go a long way in order to achieve the goals we want. But I do believe that we shall keep up with the optimism. Aliyah, I would like to add a bit. We have the Association of the National Championship. We have the chairman, so thank you very much. And we also have the Institute for Ombudsman
for
securing the business.
And
it actually has the legal initiatives, and we do hope that we'll get somewhere. Thank you very much for this addition. Let's actually switch to the next. I would like to keep you at the end so that the minister will have to listen to our internal cuisine and then we'll react and actually share the
experience.
Let's actually think about the key constituent element of the innovation, which is the scientific part. It is absolutely clear that we have different types of innovations, organizational, marketing, etc. But usually, whenever we're talking about innovations, first of all, we mean the technology innovations. They are related in a way with the science development levels, with the scientific engagement, efficiency, the sector develops and generates the solutions that may be commercialized and implemented and provided as the final product and implemented of the enterprises. Therefore, I have the following question probably to Vadim as the representative of the ministry that elaborates and generates policy in this sphere.
Деятельность научного сектора.
Actually provide the activity of the sector. The questions are pretty much the same.
But we do know that you have your own prospect, your own vision and end point of view. Where are we at? What shall we do in order for the innovations in the country to develop and liberate at a faster pace? And we are talking about the scientific approach. Thank you very much, dear friend.
Well,
we have already heard that innovations are not the priority in the relation. But, however, they become this more and more, and they believe, I believe they will become very important
internal approach.
We shall do it through the positive results, specific success stories, some case studies that could be demonstrated by other ones, by other companies, and we gather together and we collect these types of stories, and I believe this will boost up the innovative industry development in Russia. So, before the ancient times, I used the terminology of our audience up to this modern times. We think that this is the stage of institutional stabilization of innovative system. We've done a lot during this period, and actually this way is quite tricky. It's a venture in the essence, and therefore I believe it's highly important that in this presentation, and now actually Владимир Путин says that we need to continue marching this way. At the same time, for the participants, we need to minimize the risk of such type of venture participation. And we can say that the technology company shall have the right to risk. This is a very important notion, because when we work with our project office, we meet with specific business projects, so the medium and small business reacts a lot. And they say, we shall not have fear to get into the projects related to financing, to budget financing. We shall not be scared of that if we fail to achieve specific results, then the consequences will be very terrific that can ruin the business as a whole. This is the vision of the world that goes up in our minds.
Of course, we will continue developing our research infrastructure, and today we can see that young people go into science more and more, and young people go into innovation. And our audience today, here and now, is quite young, but at the same time, we have mature people and experienced people. So, and this is a good sign for us, I believe. We've implemented all together, and I'm really grateful to my colleagues, and using this chance, I'd like to express this gratitude to the Ministry of Economics, Ministry of Digital Development. Why? Because every area we work together without splitting it by the industrial principle. We finished the first stage in 2019 of implementing our national projects, education and science. And I have to tell you, we have already first results. If we speak about innovation, the development should be continuous and the system should be continuously changing. And we see quite good results. In 2019, we outlined first powerful and innovative centers, which will become the mechanism to bring closer the industry and the scientific and educational institutions, to bring them together and to provide better results and implementation in the economy of our country in order to be able to see qualitative changes, emergence of new technologies, emergence of new specialists, which will be only sought for by the Agency of Strategic Development, and tomorrow they will demand for our energy. 5 educational center is just the first start. There will be 15 of such centers. And in this regard, the structure which was founded by the government incentivizes the activity of regions. And there is a dozen of projects like this. Educational centers have to solve tasks of regions, also in terms of the quality of life and sorting out acute problems which our regions face now. There are three genome research centers, and they will act not on a standalone basis, but they will work as consortia, involving in their environment many other enterprises and institutions and working on a supra-regional level. There are four international mathematical centers in plans, and in this regard, dear colleagues, we are strengthening the competences which are competitive today in our country, really competitive. In the global markets, they are competitive too, and they are based on the experience of working on developments and researches in the fundamental science. Within the National Project Science, the state support is provided for technological R&D centers. There are four centers like this were created, 14 centers like this were created. At the one of the recent meetings of the intergovernmental group under the guidance of our Vice Premier and the Mr. Belousov, the assistant to the President, was decided to support the initiative to create in perspective two more centers on photonics and on modeling and designing technologies for fixed properties materials. In general, for 2018-2019, we sent around 6.7 billion rubles for the development of 14 centers. More than 350 actors are involved in these centers, and more than 150 research projects were started. I have to point out that we see a positive experience of such work, of innovative working as the engineering centers established based on our engineering organization. 72 engineering centers were established along with the Ministry of Development in 39 regions of the country. In the half of the regions of the country, we today have this form of the work. And just recently, we mentioned it just as one of the tasks. And the money invested in this system for today were completely repaid, three times more, judging by the investment volumes and judging by the results of the activity of the centers. A number of conditions created for the innovative entrepreneurship. For today, we understand very well that for us, it is very important to actively build up the number of examples in specific projects and products of intellectual activity of our scientists. We understand, and along with the Academy of Science, we do a lot to reduce the implementation time. It's not only important to find and formulate the idea, it's very important to monetize and bring to market these ideas. In order to support our community, our young community, to create an opportunity for very active brainstorming activity. We, together with our colleagues from NTI platform, we realized a number of steps in order to increase these boiling points. And in our universities, we reached 88 boiling points in educational institutions of the Russian Federation. For now, we have 88 such communities. So, in conclusion, I'd like to say that this entire experience can be concentrated and can be implemented in the new forms and new shapes, which are just in the beginning of their journey for now. But we need to mention them. We take part in this work together with the Ministry of Economics. This is implementation of a full-scale initiative to create technological valleys and innovative centers in Russia. And in the end of 2019, Dmitry Medvedev signed an instruction to create an innovative center of chemistry, Mendeleev Valley, based on Mendeleev Chemical Institute. I'd like to point it out now because it's not a traditional role. You take my breath. Yeah, I support you just in this regard. And there will be enough bread for everyone in innovation, by the way, dear colleagues. And we are looking with optimism in the new year, at the new year, and with common efforts, we will bridge the gaps and replenish the deficits which we see in the innovative area of our country. Thank you. Thank you very much, Russian Academy of Science.
Прошла достаточно большой путь, я имею в виду именно в контексте инноваций,
in terms of innovations.
В целом, история Академии.
I don't speak about the general history of our academy, starting from the negation and refusal of the role of the academy in the innovative policy, fundamental research, they don't have no applied output, the monetization goals couldn't be set, and then middle of notice the position changed, the innovative program of the Academy was adopted, and at that time, as far as I understand it now, there was a clear understanding, given that there are several areas of the scientific knowledge where it is difficult to get a product from the fundamental knowledge, but nevertheless, there are a lot of areas where borders are quite vague between fundamental research and the next creation of a product. The Academy of Science received large authorities in coordinating all fundamental researchers, expertise and documents. How the Academy of Science of Russia see the current status of the innovative policy and the role of the Academy of Science in the future innovative development? If you allow, I would start to express my personal opinion, and then I will move over to the high academic problem. As a person who worked the whole life in the science, starting from lab worker to the academy, mission, I passed all the steps of the career. I understand that people who are involved in the fundamental science in a focused way, they don't have time to think about the ways how to implement it in the industry. They just don't see their innovative ways. They are quite naive sometimes in these understandings, and it's hard to expect that the scientists who work in such serious fundamental areas of science will be able to become pioneers of innovative process. It also would be naive to think like this. On the other hand, and as I see it, industry, business, till recently was not much interested in science. Normally they think we have own researchers and own scientists, and you can, go your way with your research and with your science. We will do it on our own, they would say. I was quite a long time the head of the lab in the Northern Caucasus, and there were problems with our big telescope. By the way, the telescope was built 50 years ago. Since that time, nothing else was built in the country, none of the big optical tool for astronomy. So just half of the century we keep talking, but we're not able to build anything. So myself as a director, since we need to update the mirror, the receivers, very high-tech equipment, I applied to the majority of rich people of the country who work in business, in commerce, and industry. I sent 25 letters to the richest people of the country. I didn't receive any answer. It's absolutely not interesting for them. It was, quite long ago, 10 years ago, but nevertheless, I don't think that the picture changed drastically in this regard. Today, we say that obviously for innovative process, to start innovations and to make them work, and everything is there. We have mechanisms, we have innovative strategy, we have legislation, we do have the standards and norms, we have some money, not very big ones, but nevertheless, we do have them for the innovative development. But the mechanism doesn't work. It looks like an engine with all the tools, with the piston and gears and fuel, but it doesn't work. It's just a bunch of components, and that's it. And the most important thing is to get an answer how to get it work. Why Koreans? We recently had a South Korean delegation in our country. The Ministry of Science of Korea told us about 1961. It was the center of Seoul, was ruined, the rubbish in the streets, not developed. In 1961, the first innovative center was built. The science park was built in Seoul at that time. The program was realized very quickly. In our case, we do it very slowly. The specialists who are there here today, people who know more, they should answer to this question, I think. My proposal would be the following. First, I believe that we don't have intermediaries. We don't have enough people, specialists who are able on a professional level, find out the best things which are done in the science and implement it to bring it to business, and vice versa. We don't have enough people who would say that this thing is needed, please, scientists, go and do it. These people, we don't have in the necessary quantity. We should targetedly prepare and train them, and here we need to work together with the Ministry of Education, and we should seriously address this problem. Second, I believe that our country is extremely scary and cautiously in the funding of fundamental science. The model science shouldn't be done by peanuts and low budgets. We just try to survive. Although we see some better trends in the recent days in terms of funding, but it doesn't mean that we do not need to revisit our academic science and industrial science. But the science, the funds which are sent to science, they are insignificant and don't allow the science to develop in a proper way. Just an example. The Joint European Observatory is now building a telescope which will be called extremely big. Telescope of Europe will be installed now with a mirror of 39 meters, the mirror diameter. It's a combined mirror. It has around 1,000 components. It's an exclusive instrument which will use all highest technologies the humankind now has. The best thing will be implemented in this telescope, but it would mean 1 or 2.5 billion euros. It's a huge amount of money invested. Whether we will have some payback in terms of industry, of course we will. The whole European industry is involved in this process. It means new jobs, new technologies, materials, PC technologies, computerized technologies, data storage. This is the moving forward. If we don't buy anything for 50 years, the output will be the same, nothing. I have to tell you that people usually don't understand just simple thing, that the physician, a physicist who is involved in a research thing, which would seem quite naive and not clear, this physicist gives move forward. Here we have just boron matter, which we can touch, feel, smell, these parts which we are created of. But there are also a lot of dark matter, which is not visible. It exists here. It's less than boron matter, but in the universe, matter is 23%. We have only 4%, the stars and galaxies. And this matter is the one of the and we I don't speak about dark energy, but just dark matter, 23%. The physics who are looking, using very, who are looking and working on the very expensive equipment, and they, if they understand it, after a couple of decades, the humankind will get access to the new sources of energy, which will change the life of our planet because of the climate change and pollution and so on and so forth. We can save our planet by this. First, we need to prepare and train specialists, not to be scared of investing big money in the big science because it will pull up big technologies. It is the same as the moon program of the U.S., it enhanced the development of the country because thousands of companies were involved. And finally, Russian Academy of Science, now, after the reformation of 2013, more than 6 years passed, it is still in the search of the platform where it's going to be useful for our country. We understand a lot, we know a lot, we feel a lot, but resources of the Russian Academy of Science is not used, are not used by our ministries. 2,000 members of the Academy is just the top of the iceberg. There are a lot of teams and very serious specialists and any serious project which can emerge anywhere in Rosnano, or in Skolko, wherever. You can resort to the Russian Academy of Science. We can get together on a specialist and give our expert opinion in very short term. The third proposal, to make a start the innovation process in this area, to use the Russian Academy of Science as a top community of people who are very knowledgeable in this area and who can give you proper advice in implementing of method or product or development. Something like this. Thank you very much. Оксана, you can go. Good luck to you. I'd like to comment just a few words. One idea which I agree and the other one which I disagree. You started with saying that you shouldn't wait from academicians who are involved in fundamental science. You shouldn't expect business results from them. This is absolutely right. Moreover, there's a very simple definition which needs to be repeated hundreds of times. The difference between science and innovation. Science means the turning money to knowledge. Innovation means turning knowledge into money. These are two extreme processes in their essence, absolutely opposite ones, including the mindset of those who are involved in both of them. And it's absolutely right. And you shouldn't expect that the Academy of Science would create an innovative business for us for a couple of trillion of rubles. This is one side. The other side of the case, I wanted to object. You mentioned funding. Of course, all the representatives of the Academy of Science tell about it. It's absolutely natural, but it is very well known that we keep talking in our country that we don't have enough level of funding, of R&D is 1.1%, much lower than in other countries, but we need to get into it a little bit deeper. As soon as you get into this 1.1%, you will see that 1% is state funding, budget funding of the science of 1% of GDP is one of the highest indicators in the world. One of the highest indicators. We don't have problems with state funding. We have problems with non-governmental funding. We have problems with the fact that business doesn't have demand for the science. This is the fact we should start with, that business didn't turn into the innovative side. We can see the situation for the other side. We have 103 plants which were built, which produce something which was not produced before in Russia. They are in definition produced the high-tech products. On definition, they cannot exist in the business if they will not order R&D on their own. And this demand, this order for R&D is more than 40 billion rubles. And business funded 40 billion rubles. Innovative businesses, which 100% better understand what they need from you, they understand what is their order, they understand what they want to get.
So, therefore, I would like to clarify the position. I will be quite sharp, but so that you can understand. We don't like some severe thesis. We don't need to increase the budget financing level for the academic science. We are absolutely sure to create innovative businesses that will finance science. clients, and these are different things, different values. But finance probably is not right fit there, because they will buy
Yeah, of course.
I'm not talking about terminology. When I'm talking about finance, I mean business order, order of the business for the scientific results.
But in this context, the state also finances the orders. It's not just the money. Не бизнес, не продукты, но научные результаты высокого уровня, тоже заказ.
Мы понимаем, Олег Владиславович, как уважаемое министерство, какое-нибудь министерство, не буду называть какое, получив
условно,
это, с такой любовью оно выкладывает себе на полочку, так что, не дай бог, никто его никогда не открыл, никто не спросил, что там будет. Это заказ
away, по определению
Нет, я про другое, я про то, что у нас нет финансирования как такового в науке, в терминах потратить деньги на что так, что так мы ожидаем результат, либо в виде бизнеса, если бизнес-заказ, либо государство ожидает высокого качества исследований, которые бы продвигали в целом там, страну. И так это тоже нельзя говорить, что у нас есть какой-то просто трата денег.
Да,
другое дело, что мы неэффективно с заказчиком можем выступать. Это другой вопрос. Но это, на самом деле, отвлеченный спор, он напрямую к нашей сессии не относится. Я предложил тогда господину министру все-таки как-то вот мы первый раунд закончим, отрефлексировать и, по сути, тех проблем, которые Россия пытается решить, насколько они соотносятся с тем, что Сербия делает, и вообще ваш собственный опыт, опыт вашей страны в построении инновационной
экономики. Спасибо. Но сначала хочу сказать, что вопросы, они общие. Они такие, и Сербия, они такие большинство стран Евросоюза, но они и в других странах такие. Действительно, это фундаментальный вопрос. Я коротко хочу сказать, значение инноваций, вот упомянул Анатолий Борисович, бассейн без воды, насколько я помню, да? Вот как раз одна инновация, которая показала, как люди могут сделать действительно успех, это всем известный наш теннисист сербский Джокович. Во время бомбардировок у него не было возможности тренироваться, он был ребенком, и даже хотели там просто остановить его карьеру молодого теннисиста. Не имел где тренироваться на бомбардировке, нету кортов там. Но его отец действительно инноватор хороший, нашел пустой бассейн, олимпийский бассейн, и Джокович действительно год, весь год тренировал в пустом бассейне, таком, без воды. И вот, вот что такое маленькая инновация, и вот как она превращается в этот успех. Но на самом деле, должен сказать, что мы за последние три года из страны, которая последних 30 лет имела дефицит бюджета, сейчас уже три года подряд имеем профицит. И он исключительно из-за инновационного цифрового бизнеса. И два года подряд, вот недавно как раз по оценке Financial Times, Сербия, если смотреть per capita, страна, которая номер один по привлечению прямых иностранных инвестиций, если смотреть per capita в мире. Но большинство из этих привлеченных инвестиций это действительно инновационные бизнесы, много крупных компаний, которые открывают R&D-центры. Как пример, скажем, Microsoft, он имеет только два Нёкровска центра в Европе, только два, один из них находится в Сербии. Но это благодаря науке, это благодаря действительно системе образования, которая дает хорошие инженеры. Но школа сербской инженерии, она действительно, я бы сказал, какой-то микс российской технические школы, научные школы и немецкие. Мне кажется, вот это дает сейчас результат. Но я смотрю действительно оптимистически и на российскую ситуацию, и на сербскую, и на большинство европейских стран, которые сегодня не лидеры, как Израиль или Соединенные Штаты в инновациях. В инновациях нужен континуитет. Если смотреть США, они вкладывают раньше как государство, сегодня исключительно это частный бизнес, вот это тоже, что Чувайс говорил. Они вкладывают, частный бизнес вкладывает инновации, но они как государство создавали силиконовую долину государственным деньгам.
исключительно государственный договор. Поэтому нужен континуитет, я бы сказал, это 3-4 десятилетия, если не 5 десятилетий, когда действительно можно получить такой результат. Тоже, мне кажется, что нужна поддержка стартапам. Господин Поляков говорил про проблему, что существует и в России, но также большинство европейских стран, большинство, при СИН-финансировании существует, но как компании выходят на серьезный уровень, большинство европейских компаний покупают компании силиконовой долины. Большинство. Действительно, смотрите, все аквизиции в Евросоюзе, большинство, если говорить про инновационные компании, что в биотехе, что в health-техе и в других отраслях, большинство идет там, где больше, чем все вот этого частного финансирования. Ну, и мне кажется, очень важно вот сказать, что инновация, она есть и научная категория, и технологическая, но она прежде всего, инновация фундаментальная, это чисто экономическая категория. И там основной вот все-таки вопрос бизнеса. Тоже второй фактор влияющий, мне кажется, это выход на международные рынки. Сегодня большинство вот этого успеха европейских стран, если смотреть Израиль, почему Израиль? Israel, ну, они практически ориентированы все время на международный рынок, не сотрудничают с одними своих соседов, все время любая стартап-компания уже смотрит на американский рынок, европейский рынок или другой. Я могу сказать, что вот когда мы поменяли в Сербии, когда создали вот эти институты как Министерство по инновациям, у нас, скажем, 4 года назад экспорт IT-услуг был там 300 миллионов евро. В этом году, в прошлом, 2019, экспорт IT-услуг 1,5 миллиарда евро за 4 года. Просто, может быть, 1,5 миллиарда евро экспорта для России, это не такая большая цифра, но для маленькой Сербии, вот это у нас огромнейшая цифра. И наш весь суфицит бюджета и весь экономический подъем, который в этом году ожидаем где-то почти 5%, исключительно для счет этого инновационного и цифрового бизнеса. Но я скажу, мы тоже облегчили немножко налоговую систему. Все компании, которые занимаются intellectual property и вот инновационным бизнесом, облагаются не стандартным налогом 15% налогом на прибыль, а 3%. Вот везде, где можно показать, что это интеллектуальная собственность, это облагается действительно инновационным, очень низкий ставок. И мне кажется, что главные партнеры для стартап-компаний, вот это как раз частные корпорации. И мне кажется, вот частные корпорации надо давать возможность. Мы взяли какую-то модель между Скандинавией и Израилем. Мы сейчас мотивируем большие корпорации покупать стартап-компании. И делаем такс-кредит от 25%. Значит, если он купил стартап-компанию, в 4 года она работает, он практически не платил никакой налог на это. Мне кажется, вот это как раз есть система, которая облегчает и мотивирует крупнейшие частные корпорации. Я не верю в этот бизнес. Государство может помогать этим финансовым институтам, мне кажется, коллеги подробно об этом говорили, но все равно заказчик инноваций и науки, на самом деле, научных исследований, это частный бизнес. У нас, к сожалению, и большинство европейских стран, долго будем двигаться до уровня Швейцарии, или там, скажем, 90% науки и инноваций финансируется от страны частного сектора. У нас, к сожалению, еще в этом переходном периоде большинство финансируется сегодня, к сожалению, от страны государства. И на концу хочу добавить, что, чтобы закончить с этим, продолжить с этим образованием. Мне кажется, существует огромнейшая нехватка инженеров. У нас сегодня где-то 25% всех выпускников вузов это инженеры, ну, технические науки. Мы поставили цель где-то следующих 15 лет, чтобы выход инженеров с вузов был 51%. Америка давно еще поставила эту цель, они близки этой цели, и мне кажется, вот в системе образования коллега вот здесь, замминистра, он лучше эту проблему знает, но сегодня мы, как страна, вот я прошу, чувствуем уже нехватку инженеров, уже нехватку, потому что пришло очень много иностранных компаний, и надо сказать, международное сотрудничество между Россией и Сербией надо больше развивать. Вот именно в инновационной сфере потенциал есть, и надо его использовать.
Спасибо. У нас аналогичные проблемы, безусловно, есть. Обменялись как раз, Вадим, у нас несколько есть даже старых, по-моему, уже поручений по поводу увеличения приема выпуска, соответственно, по инженерным специальностям. Сейчас аналогичные поручения по цифровой экономике. Такое ощущение, что если вот мы каждую проблему так будем решать, у нас, в принципе, скоро по другим специальностям некого будет выпускать. Хотя сегодня предложены демографические меры, оставляют нам надежду, что все-таки кто-то будет по другим специальностям тоже учиться. Давайте так, вот у нас как бы основной блок обсуждения обязательной программы закончилась, произвольная началась. Мы, я думаю, с учетом внешних обстоятельств, может быть, даже чуть пораньше закончим, но до этого я хотел бы сказать про темную сторону инновационной политики, вопрос задать. Давайте вернемся, собственно, к бизнесу, с вершин государственной политики. У нас в инновационной стратегии в свое время был такой небольшой разделчик, который мы называли влияние общей экономической политики на инновации. Такая была своего рода подстраховка, когда мы пытались объяснить, что вообще говоря, когда мы говорим об инновационной политике, она не самостоятельная в значительной степени, а зависит от того, как в том числе правительство реализует другие направления политики, такие как налоговая политика, политика в сфере образования, политика в сфере науки и так далее и тому подобное. И вот этот разделчик, он на самом деле в значительной степени, может быть, и объясняет, в том числе и то, что мы очень многого из реализации инновационной стратегии не достигли, потому что у нас, если брать аналогию с злополучной пирамидой Маслоу, которую изучают там на первых курсах всех экономических вузов, которые многократно уже там пересмотрены, провернуты и так далее. Но логика такая, когда у предприятия, у бизнеса, пирамиде его потребностей на первых местах, контроль проверки, правоохранительные органы, налоги, поиск дешевого финансирования, решение кадровой проблемы, социальная нагрузка в рамках местных, региональных бюджетов и так далее. На вершине этой пирамиды потребностей оказывается инновационная политика, которая, в принципе, как бы становится заложником того, что предприятие может просто по этой пирамиде до нее и не дойти. У меня короткий вопрос по такому очень серьезному поводу, что называется, достаточно ли тех мер, понятно, что недостаточно, инновационной политики, чтобы как-то сподвигнуть бизнес к инновациям? И есть ли при такой обстановке вопрос хоть какое-то светлое пятно в инновационной, светлое будущее инновационной политики? Потому что понятно, что все те проблемы, про которые я сказал, в одночасье и ближайшие там 2-3, там даже 5 лет вряд ли удастся решить. Но вот как в этих условиях бизнесу стать чуть более инновационно активным? Это же речь не про федеральную структуру. Скорее, по то, что нужно искать какие-то неконвенциональные стимулы для бизнеса. Если уж мы налоговую политику не реализуем, проинновационную, может, что-то другое сработает. Вот вопрос для всех, кто хочет на него ответить, я по порядку не буду спрашивать. Никто не захочет просто подвисеть вопрос. Тогда зал обратимся, может, в зал будет вопрос участникам ответить. Есть желающие, но попытаться ответить.
Is there any volunteers to answer? I won't say that I really want to do this, but at least I will try to say my thoughts about this. You know, I understand the picture as follows. If we take it seriously and at large, the success of innovative policy depends on two groups of factors. Group one, the state or country innovative policy with all these components and elements, ecosystem, legal and finance part. Component two, fundamental institutes acting within the economy and in the country. When you say, similar to pyramid of Maslow, the innovation is not on the top priority, but it's the bottom priority.
Наоборот, он находится на вершине пирамиды, но чтобы до него дойти, нужно сначала решить более базовые потребности у предприятия. Наименее приоритетно. Да, ну, ровно то, что я хотел сказать, что
this is exactly what I wanted to say. Innovative have not become the top priority for private or state business. In order to turn this picture upside down, we need to think about a small institute like private equity, private property. We need to protect it. It's good to know that whatever we have in our Constitution, and our Constitution actually says that the private property protection is extremely
important.
Actually, Vladimir Putin is not supposed to change anything, so let's try to implement whatever we have in our Constitution. Yet better to protect not only the private property, but actually the owner of this private property. Because, as we know, very often, attacking the owner of the property is a way to get out of his or her property. And therefore, everything changes our minds from upside down. We go to a different way, and now we start talking about absolutely different things. If we continue this logic, two groups of factors. Group one is the innovative state system. The second one is the fundamental institution. If you want to get the real breakthrough, you need to change everything. This is what's the point one. Point two, do we have any chances to change the second point? No. No. And there will never be in the nearest future. That is why we need to stand still, think wise, and assess our reality, and actually try to construct our state or country innovative system.
Thank you very much.
Anybody else? I always remember a joke about the frogs or a story about frogs.
Butter? Yeah,
one actually got pound, the other one made butter. You need to make butter. But I remember the result from the day of radio, when actually the chief editor was looking for the button.
He was asking,
can we stop this ship now? Then let's look for the button. I look for my jacket.
Коллеги, давайте мы потратим 10 минут ровно на вопросы из зала. Просьба вставать, представляться. Вопросы задавать исключительно по теме нашей сессии. Все остальные я просто буду своей властью блокировать. Пожалуйста. У нас есть микрофоны в зале?
Do we have any mic? The question is asked of the mic.
Микрофончик можно в дополнение к вашему, тот, который слышно будет?
Газета «Российские корейцы», рубрика «Роспискор». Вопрос к представителю науки, Академии наук и Анатолию Борисовичу.
Представитель науки.
Ну, Анатолий Борисович постоянно говорит про науку, поэтому инновационный вопрос для науки. Готова ли Россия сегодня инвестировать деньги и развивать, и создавать науку о мире, дружбе и примирении в противовес науке о войне, бизнесе, деньгах и финансах? И очень здорово было бы, если бы вы, как представители науки, подсказали бы, как с этой инновацией прийти. Я являюсь участником конкурса «Лидеры России», и мой проект как раз основан вот на этом постулате. То если мы хотим примиряться, дружить, то надо это делать по науке, так же, как project manager. Не видим цель, не дать цель. Это вопрос к
Российской Академии Наук, наверное, все-таки.
Это вопрос к Российской Академии Наук,
наверное, все-таки. Не в сфере, так сказать, инновационных проблем наших. Конечно, вкладывать деньги в науку о мире.
Well, of course, it's quite hard to invest money into the science of peace. It's not the science, it's not the peace. Peace is actually the topmost value of humanity. It's actually the thing we are going to, we're trying to achieve. And it's not only the matter of innovation or science, it's the question of any honest person living on the planet. And I don't think that this is the task of a science only or of innovative theme we are talking about.
Colleagues, more questions, please. If you don't have any desire, you can leave it. Please, microphone here. Do you have a microphone, please?
Не услышат вас, коллеги. Дайте микрофон, донесите, ребят. Не слышно будет залу. Мы же не вдвоем.
Спасибо. Алексей Попов, Донской государственный
Алексей Попов, Донской State University. Question to Mr. Chubais. You mentioned that budget funding of science should not be increased, but if we mention innovation, this is applied science, we can admit, but it is fundamental science with 50, 100 years horizons. Business will not fund it, because business it will consider as non-profitable. 5, 10, maximum 10 years of horizon is able to be planned. Do you believe that business will be able to support fundamental culture, archaeology, history, physics, for the future? I understand your question. Let's start with, I repeat, sorry for repeating it again. I saw that from my point of view, to increase, the key word is to increase the funding from the budget for the scientists is not needed. But I didn't say that we do not need to fund it at all. In my understanding, in order to answer the question whether a funding level is enough for academic or not, science or not, we need intergovernmental comparison. What is the average annual figure? Around 80. Well, 80 billion rubles a year is the level. 120 from the budget. No, with funds together. I think with funds. Well, okay, let's take a look. What's a fair comparison? We should compare it in shares of GDP, and maybe specialists will correct me. If I understand, if we take GDP shares, if we take the federal budget funding and funds, the fundamental science funding is in one of the first words, ranking one of the first in the world, is the biggest in the world. In the first top, at least. The Academy of Science, of course, will tell no, I don't doubt. But we should take a look at the statistics. If I just stated, if I'm wrong, then please correct me based on the statistics. If it's true, so from the global statement, let's fund science, let's understand what we need to fund, what's not. Starting from the Academy of Science up to today's speech of the president who mentioned mega science again, I agree that the observatory with the big mirror of 26, how many, 20, I remember, I was in your lab. I remember all this story. I agree that this is a huge breakthrough, but I don't know whether we are able to go for it. It's an intergovernmental project with this big telescope. Of course, yes, this is like international project, big project. Even rich European countries don't fund it completely from one budget. It's an intergovernmental story, which also shows that they have their own limits. And once again, I understand very well how you can criticize me, and this is my vulnerable position, but I take it. I believe that it's no need to increase budget funding of academic science. Not because we don't need this science, not because I don't understand that we cannot go to tomorrow without academic science, and because business would die and applied science would die without it. I don't say in no, yes, no, but I speak in logic more or less, and this is my statement. This is not popular. The budget, as you know, if you increase it here, let's propose where we can cut it. Children, medicine, first stage, what else? The even government works in this logic. And my understanding here, we should not increase funding of the research and the applied science funding, and this should come not from the budget, but from those who understand what they need. Our dispute with Oleg about what is a state order. We absolutely understand what is a state order for the academic science. This is the picture where the academic science is about understanding what should be done, would convince the bodies to make it work. I don't say this is bad. The state bodies don't understand and FOEVs don't understand. They don't need anything at all. Sorry for my French. They don't. The federal institutions don't need these reporting, but they are customers, and this is a normal situation. Once again, in the area of fundamental laws, I don't think we need to break something. I would rather think about redistributing between legal entities and tender-based funds. Between our foundations and this proportion, it's an interesting and complicated question. I'm not a specialist here, but what we do need to increase is the applied science, and not from the budget, and from business. This is my position. Thank you. My name is Osten Чешихин. International Academy of Innovative and Social Technologies. Now I'm the private investor. If we take a look at the presidential decree of 2004 on the development strategy, it is clearly stated that we need to develop private and high-speed expert analytical centers of technology territories. If we bring over the whole economics in these territories, it's clearly said that in the territories we need to develop centers which will help to develop every area and build their development strategy for a few years. In this regard, I have a question or proposal to our distinguished ministers. It would be interesting to make a meeting and to take a look at the technologies which exist and how we could use and apply them and the whole policy to send to create such innovative development centers of priority territories, which would solve the comprehensive issue of healthcare, roads, quality of living, and demography and environment. Because without solving these issues on site, everything would else would just stay as quite a good potential. Do some of the ministers have desire to make a meeting and discuss it? Thank you. This is a question to me. Thanks for your speech. Look, the centers which I already mentioned in my speech, they already placed in Nizhny Novgorod, Kemerovo, Belgorod, Tumen, and Yamal-Ненецк region, and in the Perm territory. They are all territorial ones, and we will develop this trend of territorial development. In this regard, this message to work in regions to develop technological and R&D centers in regions, this is the question on our agenda, and we will continue developing it in the next year. As for setting up a meeting, it's easy, we can do it, we can make an agreement. Thank you. My name is Osten Чешихин, author of economic books, How to Exit the Crisis. I have the plan of exiting the crisis, a plan of innovative development. I know how to make innovative breakthrough in Russia, and I believe it is needed. The most problem is develop the mindset. The pattern mindset is the big problem in Russia. We need to develop analytical mindset. Please formulate your question. I have a proposal. To whom? I have a proposal. I'd like to propose our own my proposal of innovative development, to develop mindset. To the government, our president, I'd like to resolve to all interesting parties. Okay, thank you. Then the Ministry of Science should answer.
Нет, то есть, нет, смотрите, там, коллеги, вот можно я закончу? При всем, вот понимаю настроение зала.
I understand the mood of the order. Of course you will finish.
Смотрите,
look. We're absolutely open to speak about it. And if we speak seriously, there is the whole pool of stable expert teams, dozens of experts who provide different proposals from different communities, scientific communities. And what our vice president of the Russian Academy of Science mentioned, he said that we are open for expertise, both as we and for Commonwealth. Well, of course, we should discuss it.
Если вы не уточните свой вопрос, то больше ответа вы другого не получите.
If you do not specify a question, you won't get more answers. Please, microphone in this region.
И вот после этого еще один вопрос.
And afterwards, one more question, and we finish. All other questions you can ask in us. My name is Kendrick White. Venture Capital Partners. I have 25 experience of working venture, and I work at Lobachevsky University. I see a lot of programs from the Ministry of Education, but a lot of programs have a budget of 3 years. Engineering center can get a profit, can pay back after 3 years. But what do you need? You need the proof of concept center, the pre-concept center, which would work in the internal institute. Your new problem is the
expert. To understand, it's not a question, also a proposal to discuss.
Yes, the question. The question is, can we do it within the new budget rule, not with 3 years, but for 5 to 7 years? If the proof of concept is worked for 3 years, it will be able to make only an IT project. If we make a content and other details, we need to. Yes, we understand. Thank you very much. Look, we can make it stage-wise. Because why we split the stages three by 3 years, you mentioned, as a barrier. It doesn't mean that it's a cutting off. We can work further, but we should see that we move around direction and we should have some indicators and some results. We correct something and move on. But of course, we can look at the problems of longer term, of course.
Dear colleagues, everyone who raised hands, I
give the final question to the girl. My name is Елена Сирота. I am from Taganrog. Based on statistics, we take sixth place in IT outsourcing. And here a question.
Я слушала выступление министра из Сербии, и он сказал, что мы достигли такого роста качества в связи с тем, что мы дали льготы по налогам тем предприятиям, которые занимаются IT-аутсорсинг компаниям.
On the federal level, I understand that we have some local subsidies, we can provide only the land tax subsidies. But can we move this experience to our Russian specifics? And Russian policy. Colleagues, look, we often forget what we already have in our investment, what our investment opportunities we do have already. And when we calculate them, the number of benefits, there are more than 100 in general in the country. So if we compare our country to some European countries, in this regard, Serbia, we should not only look at one subsidy, at one benefit. We should take a comprehensive look in a comparative idea. And we take a look at the experience, the foreign experience, when we develop every decision. Because our task is to be in top five of economies. We cannot go without international comparison, and we take a look at tax preferences and so on and so forth. If we should look at in total, we often do not lose in this race, and we already know where we have bottlenecks. But we do lose, and sometimes we lose, especially in the innovative business and in IT. The only significant subsidy is the social funds, and it ends under the pressure of the Ministry of Labor and supported by the Ministry of Finance. No other significant subsidies. We have upgrading coefficient, but it's not real. When we speak with business, when we make meetings, I'm the business representative, also with your participation, with leadership companies. You remember what they're talking about. They talk about not about tax subsidies. They speak about markets, about the opportunity to provide products, because no one hopes that some tax subsidies will be given. And the fact that before our taxation policy was not stimulating the innovative technologies, this is basically, openly speaking, I worked in the government of this. And I don't take off my responsibility, but the essence is I'm advocating a deeper analysis in order to understand whether this measure is efficient or not. There are a lot of measures, a lot of ways, and they can be opened really easy, but not always about the subsidy. It is about many other things. But generally speaking, the efficiency of their work, you're right, it should be analyzed whether we lack something. I think Taganrog has the only way out is to try to establish an innovative center in their territory, because significant subsidies for innovative business can be given only within special modes, which is Сколково or scientific center. If you are able to create a scientific center, you will get very good tax subsidies, which will not be inferior to Serbian ones. Unfortunately, they are not covering the whole territory of the country, but they are tied to territorial entities. Dear participants of this session, many thanks to you. Thanks for your participation and very good discussion. And special thanks to the audience that you've come, despite very interesting events happening outside of this room.